Today in this lecture, we are going to talk about the measurement of extracellular fluid volume. And then with the help of extracellular fluid volume and total fluid in the body, we are going to measure the intracellular fluid volume. Now, this lecture is specifically about measurement of extracellular fluid volume. Now, as we previously discussed, that there is around 42 liters of water or fluid in the human body, which is divided into extracellular fluid and the intracellular fluid. And the extracellular fluid and the intracellular fluid together constitute the total body water. Again, the extracellular fluid volume is divided into the plasma and interstitial fluid. Now, that is something which we discussed in detail. We also discussed how to measure the total body water, and that is something which we discussed in our last lecture about the indicator dilution method. Now, the same indicator dilution method will be used here again. Now, what we discussed in the indicator dilution method, that we take an indicator and we put it in the fluid which we want to measure, the volume of which we want to measure. Now, initially we know the volume, the mass and the concentration of this indicator, and we put it into this fluid, and then we calculate the concentration again. Now, with the help of an equation which we are going to discuss, with the help of that equation we can then calculate the volume of this fluid or any fluid in the body. For the calculation of total body water, we took an indicator or ADI, which basically could distribute evenly throughout the human body. Now, in this example, we have assumed that this yellow color fluid is basically the plasma. This orange color fluid is basically the interstitial fluid, and together they constitute the extracellular fluid. And the blue color fluid is basically the intracellular fluid volume. In our last lecture, we discussed that when we take an indicator like radioactive water or heavy water or antipyrene, and we put it into the body, this indicator basically dissolves completely or distributes completely into the extracellular, intracellular, into the interstitial fluid, into the plasma and intracellular fluid, and it distributes evenly. And with the help of this equation, we were able to calculate the volume of this fluid or the total body volume. Now, in this example, we are going to take an indicator like radioactive sodium or radioactive chloride or iothalamate or inulin. Radioactive sodium, radioactive chloride or iothalamate or inulin. Now, the quality of these indicators or these dyes or these radioactive materials is that when it is put into the body or it is injected into the body, it will only distribute in the plasma and the interstitial fluid, or it will only distribute into the extracellular fluid. A few particles or a slight amount of this indicator will enter the intracellular component, but as a whole, it will basically remain in this compartment, in the extracellular compartment. Now, it is important, we discussed, that the indicator must have the property of distributing completely in that compartment which we want to measure. So these substances, the radioactive sodium, radioactive chloride, iothalamate, inulin, they have the quality to distribute completely evenly in these compartments, the plasma and the interstitial fluid or the extracellular fluid. And it will not cross the plasma membrane. It will cross the capillary membrane. Suppose, for example, this is the plasma and here we have the capillary membrane. And when this fluid from the plasma or the inside the capillary come out into the interstitial fluid, and here we have the cell membrane. Now, this fluid can cross the capillary membrane and it can come into the interstitial fluid, but it cannot cross the cell membrane. Now, here we see, we have injected this indicator or this dye or this radioactive material into the body. It has distributed itself into the extracellular fluid. It has distributed itself into the plasma and into the interstitial fluid. Now, here you see it is present in the plasma. It is present in the plasma and it is also present in the interstitial fluid. But only traces are present in the inside the cell, or only traces are present in the intracellular compartment. But as a whole, it is not entering. It cannot cross the cell membrane. It is crossing the capillary membrane to come out into the interstitial fluid, and it is evenly distributing into the plasma, but it cannot enter the cell membrane. So these indicators, they are very much reliable for measuring the extracellular fluid. Now, once this indicator has distributed itself into the plasma and the interstitial fluid, or it has distributed itself into the extracellular fluid, then we will put the values in this equation which we discussed in the indicator dilution method. What we measured in the indicator dilution method, we assumed that the mass of the indicator is mass A, which is basically the product of volume A and concentration A. So its mass is basically the product of its volume and concentration. And we know the mass, the volume and concentration of this indicator. Basically, we know the mass, volume and concentration of this indicator. Now, when it is put into this fluid or when it is injected into the body, it will distribute into that specific compartment which we want to measure. So it has basically distributed itself in this special compartment, the extracellular compartment, which we want to measure. Now, once it has distributed, we will call it as mass B indicator. Now, from the law of conservation of mass, we know that the indicator mass before injecting and after injecting remains the same. Its concentration will decrease when it distributes. When it distributes, for example, when it distributes here, its concentration will decrease, but its mass remains the same. So we call it mass B. Now, mass B is also basically the product of volume and concentration. And by shuffling the equation, we can convert it into volume is equal to mass by concentration B. Then we know that A, mass A is basically equal to mass B. So instead of mass B, we can put the values of volume A and concentration A. The volume A and the concentration A are the volume and concentration of this indicator, which we know. So we put those values here. And the concentration of B is basically the concentration of this fluid, or concentration of B is basically the concentration of this fluid after injection of the indicator. So we initially know the mass, the volume and the concentration of this indicator, which we call as mass A, volume A, concentration A. We inject it into the body. When it distributes itself, its concentration decreases. Then we take a sample from here. And we calculate its concentration. And that is basically the concentration B. So by putting the values into this equation, the volume A into concentration A divided by concentration B, we will be able to determine the volume B, which is basically the area in which the indicator has distributed itself. So the volume B is basically the area, the compartment in which it has distributed itself. So what we know is initially we take this indicator, which may either be the radioactive sodium, radioactive chloride, or iothalamate or inulin, and we know that its mass is product of volume into its concentration, but its mass A, volume A, and concentration A. Then we inject this indicator into the body. It distributes itself into the plasma and into the interstitial fluid, which is basically, and both of them are called the extracellular fluid. Then we take a sample into this new, we take a sample and then we calculate concentration again. As it has distributed over wider area in a large amount of fluid, its concentration must have changed. When we determine its concentration, we take this equation, mass is equal to volume into concentration, or volume is equal to mass by concentration. Now, we assume that mass A is equal to mass B. So we call it mass B. And when we call it mass B, we can put the volume and concentration A. So we call mass B, volume B is equal to volume A into concentration A divided by concentration of B. And while putting, after putting the values in this equation, we can determine the extracellular fluid. Now, how to determine the intracellular fluid volume? We cannot directly determine the intracellular fluid volume because we do not have any such indicator which will not be going into the extracellular fluid and which can only go into the intracellular fluid. But we have some of the indicators like radioactive water or heavy water or antipyrene, which can basically distribute itself throughout this plasma, throughout this interstitial fluid, and throughout this intracellular space. When it distributes itself and we calculate the volume of the total body water, which we have done previously in our last lecture, we have discussed that thing in detail. So we can determine the total body water with the help of these indicators. We can determine the volume of total body water with those indicators, which dissolve completely in all compartments, which will even enter these intracellular spaces. So with the help of these dyes, the radioactive water, the heavy water, and the antipyrene, we can determine the total body water. And with the help of these indicators, the radioactive sodium, radioactive chloride, inulin, etc., we can determine the extracellular fluid. Now, to calculate the intracellular fluid, we just minus the extracellular fluid from the total body water, or we just minus the extracellular water from the total body water, and we will get the intracellular compartment. So to summarize it again, To determine the total body water, we use the indicator dilution method. Indicator dilution method is something which we have discussed in detail over a previous lecture. But to summarize it, we take an indicator, we put it in the fluid, in the compartment in which it has to completely dissolve. And there are a lot of indicators. So to calculate the total body water, we can use radioactive water, heavy water, or antipyrene as indicators. And to calculate the extracellular fluid, we take radioactive sodium, radioactive chloride, and iothalamate or inulin, etc. Now, once this indicator has been injected into the body or into the fluid which we want to determine, it will basically distribute itself and its concentration will decrease. Now, before injecting it, we know its mass, we know its volume, and we know its concentration. And we know that its mass is basically the product of its volume and concentration. And before injecting it, we call it volume A, mass A, volume A, and concentration A. Then we inject it into the fluid. Then its volume, its mass basically remains the same. Its mass remains the same, but definitely its volume and concentration changes. So its mass remains the same. Its mass A is basically equal to its mass B. So what we want to determine the volume B. So volume B is also equal to equal to the product of volume B and concentration B. So mass B is basically is the product of volume B and concentration B. By shuffling the equation, we can get the volume B. And we put the values in here in this equation by further shuffling this equation. Instead of writing mass B, we can write the volume A, concentration A, because mass A is basically equal to mass B. So instead of mass B, we can write mass A, and mass A is basically the product of volume A and concentration A. So this is the final equation, and we put the values and we can determine the volume of the fluid. So if we use these radioactive water, heavy water, antipyrene, we can calculate the total body water with the help of indicator dilution method. But if we use the radioactive sodium, radioactive chloride, iothelamate, we can determine the extracellular fluid with the same equation, with the same dilution indicator dilution method. Then by removing when we remove the extracellular fluid from the total body water, we can determine the intracellular water volume as well. So that's all about the methods that are basically used in calculating or determining the total body water and the extracellular fluid and the intracellular fluid. And that's basically a summary of indicator dilution method. If you want to completely understand the indicator dilution method, then you must watch our previous lectures. You will completely understand this process. It's very simple and easy. Thanks a lot for watching the video.